started. So thank you all very much for coming out, and thank you to Leslie and Teresa and Eliza and Burning Books for making this possible, and Vikki for coming out. So I'm going to just quickly tell you what's going on tonight, and then get out of the way so that Vikki can talk. So when Leslie emailed me back in December to talk about bringing Vikki Law here, we jumped at the opportunity and just jumped kind of slowly, and it took us 6 months to get it together. But we got it together. And so tonight, Vicky's going to talk about her work after I introduce her. And then hopefully maybe you'll be interested in getting one of her books afterwards, and there'll also be plenty of time to ask any questions that you have of her. I just want to announce briefly a few events that are going on over the next week here that I'm just going to pass out the flyers for. So basically Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday of the next week, there are events happening that you can take a look at these little flyers for. But one that I will draw your attention to on Thursday, Will Potter, the author of Green is the New Red, about the sort of the invention of eco-terrorism and the prosecution of so many people around this green scare. He'll be here, and that will be a really special event, so I want to make it out for that if you're free next Thursday. Also, the reason I'm up here is because I'm one of the people who started the Buffalo Prison Abolition Reading Group. We meet on the third Friday of most months. We'll meet on the third Friday of July, July 19th, if you're interested in coming out. Once a year, we have like an organizational planning meeting where we don't have any readings for it. We just get together and think about the next year. That's what we'll be doing July 19th. So please join us here, 6 p.m., Friday, July 19th, if you're interested. Whether or not you're interested in that, you can sign up for our email list. You'll get maybe 2 emails a month, not too many. We try not to have any brutalists or battles on it or anything like that. So anyways, I'm going to introduce Vikki, and while I do so, I'm going to hand around this basket. And this basket is very important because you put money in it so that events like this can happen more often. And so, think about what your other nighttime plans might be, how much you would spend on a regular Friday night of entertainment, and, throw that much in there.
So $600?
Yeah, I think so. But,
not everybody's a party animal, but
I think that's a fair sum to start with. So anyways, give what you can. Also consider buying a book, many of the books here, but particularly Vicky's books. Let me tell you a little bit about this woman. It is my great honor to introduce writer, photographer, and mother, Victoria Law. In 1996, she helped start Books Through Bars in New York City, a group that sends free books to prisoners nationwide. In 1997, she organized a group of activist photographers to transform one of ABC No Rio's upstairs tenement apartments into a community darkroom. Since then, she has remained actively involved in coordinating free photography classes for neighborhood youth. In 2000, she began concentrating on the needs and actions of women in prison, drawing attention to their issues by writing articles and giving public presentations. Since 2002, she has worked with women incarcerated nationwide to produce Tenacious, art and writings from women in prison, which I believe we have copies of here. In 2003, she collaborated with China Martins to create Don't Leave Your Friends Behind, a workshop addressing the specific and often unacknowledged needs of parents and children in radical movements. That workshop is now a book, her second book, after Resistance Behind Bars, The Struggles of Incarcerated Women, which BPARB read in March of 2012. So those books and the zine are both available here. And without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Vikki Law.
Thanks, everyone. I'm doing a sort of like double workshop session presentation on like the issues in both books. So I'm going to start with my latest book, Don't Leave Your Friends Behind, and like ways that we in social justice movements and communities can support the families and caregivers in our midst. So just to start people thinking, just by a quick show of hands, like how many of you are parents or primary caregivers? All right. How many of you work with kids? All right. How many of you have kids in your lives? Like neighbors, nieces, nephews? Okay, awesome. Great. So one little bit of housekeeping. We have at least one child here. Maybe there will be joined by more. Kid noises should actually always be welcome in our movement. It's a sign of our movement growing, you know? So when we think about like kids' noises, we should be like, great, our movement is growing. And see, our movement is growing by more, because here's another child that's going to come. So if the kid noises are a little distracting, feel free to move up to the front, you know, like, or ask me to speak up, ask me to repeat things, you know, like, so everybody is welcome to like, you know, like, be part of this workshop. Everybody's welcome to participate. If you are a grown up with a cell phone, I would ask you to take it outside. You know, but, so cell phone noises, I don't feel like are that sign bar. They're just distracting. So, and again, you know, for the youth and person who just dealt that walked in, kid noises are welcome. They're a sign of our movement growing. And see, and here are more people growing. Can somebody help that small person come in? They want to come in. And again, if you have a hard time hearing because of some of our lovely noises of movement growing, just move on up to the front or ask me to speak up or ask me to repeat something. So since we're talking about movements growing, I wanted to start with a historical example of how a social justice movement, you know, like, incorporated childcare into like the social justice work they were doing. So in 1970, one of the 7 demands presented to the administration of Lincoln Hospital in the South Bronx was a free daycare center for the children of patients, workers, and visitors at the hospital. So basically they were saying, like, if you are coming to this hospital in the South Bronx, which is primarily a poor people of color neighborhood, you should be able to leave your children, you know, at this daycare center, whether you're a worker, you're going to visit somebody in the hospital, or you actually have to be in the hospital. After waiting a month with no response from the hospital, the people of the South Bronx, including the young lords, gave the administration a deadline of July 31st. And when that deadline passed, at 1 a.m. on July 31st, they opened a daycare center at Lincoln Hospital. And it was opened not by the administration, but by the people of the South Bronx. And so that first day, and every day since then, the center held 50 to 60 children of patients, workers, and visitors. The children were served free lunch and snacks, taught Puerto Rican history, African history, karate, art, and got answers to any questions that they asked. And the daycare center was run by volunteers from the young lords. So like when we think about like what we think about radical history, you know, like that's a little bit we should be thinking about.
What are the young lords?
Okay, the young lords is, or was, a group of Puerto Rican activists based in New York City. They were advocating on behalf of Puerto Rican liberation and for conditions around Puerto Rican people in the United States. It comes out of that whole movement of people deciding that they needed self-determination for their communities and that change wasn't gonna come from the top down. So like it comes out of that tradition of like the Black Panthers, you know, organizing for liberation, and the Chicano movement, and the Young Lords were, you know, like the Puerto Rican liberation movement of the time. And so according to the Palante, the newspaper of the Young Lords, they said, the parents were pleased and they asked, why hasn't anyone thought of this before? What took so long for a center to open? This is beautiful. And what some of these parents did not realize was that this was not the result of an individual action. This was united power. The power of the people created this daycare center. So I give you this example not to say that you should all go out and open daycare centers where they're needed, although if you decide to do so, that would be really welcome and really appreciated, but to show that past social justice movements have often prioritized childcare and not shunted it off to the side, like we often see today. Hey there, are you gonna come in? All right, so moving into the present. A couple of weeks ago, I was at the Montreal Anarchist Book Fair, where there was a kids zone, which was not just childcare, where you just like leave your kids and they color for like hours on end, but also kids activities, including indoor and outdoor games, or there would have been outdoor games had it not been pouring the entire weekend, but they planned for outdoor games, parachutes and soccer balls and all this stuff. You know, like they did silk screening workshops for kids so kids could like learn to silk screen. Like, you know, like they had a button making workshop, they got a button maker so kids could like make their own little buttons, you know, like in other activities that kind of made them feel a little bit more included with what was going on like in the greater workshops. And so there were about 30 kids in and out of the kid zone. that weekend. One time I went, they told me that there had been 150 kids, you know, like in and out of their kid zone all weekend, you know, and they were like totally down for like having that many youth participate. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the Montreal Book Fair is not the only time that there have been kids' activities at like radical or anarchist type conferences and movements. When my daughter was six, we went to the U.S. Social Forum in Atlanta, and we specifically went for the Children's Social Forum, which basically was not just child care again, but like actual activities. So the people organizing the Children's Social Forum pulled in cultural workers and people doing political work from around Atlanta to be like, will you do a workshop geared towards youth of a certain age? And you know, the people that they pulled in did workshops around, say, like gentrification, where they actually like did like a model where they'd be like, okay, here are like little houses that we build, and now what happens when, you know, like people who are living in these houses get pushed out? And they did it in a way that I think my daughter's group was like the like 6 to 8 year olds, you know, like could understand and grasp. So you, maybe they didn't get into all the nuances, but it's like, here's an introduction as to what that looks like. You know, somebody else did like a capoeira workshop where he sat kids down and like they talked about like, you know, like the history of capoeira. They talked a little bit about slavery, about Brazil. Do you know where Brazil is on this map? You know, and then they got into the body movement. So again, like the kids were included in all this, and some of these activities mirrored the larger adult, you know, US Social Forum. My co-editor, China, is part of an amazing collective called Kid City, which that works with conferences and events to organize, again, not just child care, but kids' activities, like what can we do with kids? And they ask people from the conference and the events to come and volunteer at, you know, like the child care or the kids' activities. And they're like, hey, what can you contribute? What, you know, like whether it be like people who are like, I'm not really comfortable with kids, but I can come and bring the snacks, you know, or I can be on security if there's like something that happens that you need like us to, like, you know, like get down there really fast, or you need like emergency attention. And then some people are like, hey, I can do a sewing workshop, or I can do, you know, like a build a city with boxes, you know, for kids that kind of need more rambunctious activity. But they work with people planning events. So it's not just like you do childcare and it's marginalized and that's your work. You know, it's like, how can this entire event start thinking of ways that we can make these like spaces, you know, like kid inclusive and kid friendly? And then in a couple of weeks, I'm going to the Allied Media Conference, which has had since 2008 what they call the Kids Track, which is basically like a track for kids where there's childcare and like kids get to hang out, they go to the playground and they hang out with each other. But then they also have people come in and do, again, like sort of workshops geared towards kids. So the first year my daughter went when she was like 7 or 8, like somebody came in and they did like, you know, like how to make, you know, like how to make a stencil and how to spray paint your stencil, which the kids thought were so cool, you know. So they had these like little like, you know, like respirators, you know, like, and they learned how to like make their stencil and then cut out their stencil, and then they actually went around, you know, like, and they spray painted, you know, their stencil with their, you know, like they were explaining like why you wear this respirator that's bulky and awkward and uncomfortable, but like, you know, like, and what, like, you know, like what that would look like. And then they did another workshop with seed bombing, which, like, if you think about Detroit, you think about like urban decay, you think about a lot of lots, you don't think about like green, you know, beautiful spaces. And they taught the kids how to make seed bombs. And then they went for like a walk of like 2 or 3 blocks, you know, like, and then they just like threw their seed bombs along and they like talked about that. And these were ways to like get the kids involved. And again, not just have them be like in the corner for 8 hours a day while like their parents were in bigger workshops. And so a couple of years ago, so we've been going almost every year, and a couple of years ago, my daughter went and she was just like, I'm the oldest kid here. I think she was 11. Like the next youngest, the next oldest is 8, and everybody else is like 6 and under. And this is kind of boring, you know? Like, yeah, I can play with the kids, but I don't want to spend 8 hours playing with babies, you know? Like, I kind of want to like, you know, like, you know, like be able to like hang out with older kids, but also I'm not old enough to go to the tracks that are meant for like 17, 18, 19 year old like high school students, you know, and early college students. So I don't really know if I want to come next year. And we talked with the people that were doing the kids track, you know, like, and she and another girl actually came up with this list of suggestions, you know, some of which were really awesome. Like, hey, we want to go to this museum that's like down the block, or we should do some field trips. And then they were like, we don't always want to hang out with babies. you know, like that actually was their sort of like, you know, like we don't mind sometimes, but sometimes we kind of want to be, you know, in our own group. And the people in the kids track actually took it seriously. And they were like, well, if we started to do a tween track, what would you want to get out of that. And they like started having, you know, like at age like 11 to 12, like you know, like conference calls with, you know, like kids that were like, okay, well, if we were to do this, what would you want to see out of this? You know, some of them were like, we want to do a gigantic scavenger hunt. And they were like, well, what would that look like? And so like my daughter would actually be on these calls along with a couple of other like 12 and 13 year olds where they would be like, okay, well, what do we want to see? And they'd be like, no, we don't want to do that. You know, like that actually sounds kind of boring. That sounds like you're talking at us, you know, or like, oh, we should do a scavenger hunt. And then they'd be like, oh wait, that park is really far away. You know, like we don't want to walk like 10 blocks to the park. Like what an adult can easily do, perhaps like younger people might not be able to do. And so last year, like the tween track didn't quite come into fruition. Like they only had like a couple of different pockets because it started late, because they felt like they didn't get enough volunteers to be able to be like, there's always somebody with you at all times, so you're not just kind of like unattended. But they started this fruit of being like, okay, well, what do you want to see come out of this? And like, let's develop this with the youth that are going to be in here. Because by this point, like they're like 11, 12, 13, they should know kind of what they want to do, you know? Like, and so like our job then is to kind of see that they have the ability to make that happen, you know? So I'm giving these examples of ways that like, you know, like different events and different social justice groups have like worked with, you know, like caregivers, youth to like do, hey there, you're totally welcome to come. That is fine. That is totally fine. I can do this holding a baby. Like, it's been a while since I've like done workshops holding babies, but we don't forget. So our life isn't always about events and gatherings, you know, as much as like, you know, like that would be exciting and awesome, but we know like a lot of the work just comes from like the day-to-day stuff that is not necessarily visible or glamorous, you know, like it also can be kind of isolating. And people who are parents and caregivers often need support from that. So like, hey there. So like when I was, you know, like before I had kids, it's okay that he goes, okay. So like before, you know, my daughter was born, I was one of these like, you know, like activists in my early 20s, and like, you know, like, so there was like a demonstration, a rally, like 4 a.m. court support, you know, like afterwards, like calling lawyers, all these other things that like happen, you know, like that are really invisible, like that was a thing that I would do when I was there, you know, like, and so I was always just like, go, go, go. And then when I became pregnant and had a kid, it was suddenly like, oh wait, I can't do that anymore. Like I can't be sort of on the front lines of something if I know that either I have a baby with me or I have a baby waiting for me at home and I might risk getting arrested. Or I can't be at the courthouse until 4 in the morning waiting for like, you know, like my friends to get arraigned and to get let out of jail. Or I can't be always like leading, you know, like the charge for something, you know. And I had thought that I had built up a great community of people who of course would support me. And, you know, and what I found out was that many people just didn't understand what these new limitations on my time and energy were. And they also weren't thinking about how they could make their events or their meetings or anything that they were doing kind of more conducive to me being able to participate. So like, you know, like one of the things that really struck me on my first like nights out, like away from my baby when she was really little, was I went to go table for Books Through Bars at a queer court show that was loud, it was really smoky. There wasn't like a space that like you could be able to like get away unless you wanted to sit outside on the street, you know? And somebody said to me like, oh, you just had a baby, it's so great to see you here. You know, I feel like so many times when women become moms, they get called out, I don't know what's the matter with them, you know, like they don't, you know, like we don't have women anymore. I'm thinking like, you know, like, and like, I'm kind of not really articulating this at this point, but you know, it's kind of like, wait, so this place is really loud. You know, like it is a queer show, it's loud. It's really smoky. You know, like, and like, you know, like, it's really crowded, so where am I gonna put a baby, you know, like, in this? Like, all these other people that you're really mad about, you know, like, are not gonna want to, you know, like, bring their babies out either. So if you're not seeing us, maybe it's because the space isn't really that conducive to us being there, you know? Other people just assumed that I wasn't interested. They were like, oh yeah, you know, you got a kid, you know, like, you're not interested in, like, political work or politics or making a difference. And then some people just weren't willing to make those accommodations, you know, to be like, okay, you know, like we can have our meetings not, you know, like super late or like in a big unfriendly space, or even like, okay, we can just not smoke around your kid, you know, like kind of thing. It's like, oh wait, no, I don't want to do that because it would like limit, you know, like my ability to do stuff. So it was really frustrating, So I ended up having to leave several projects that I'd been like actively involved in, and I moved on to like other projects where people were willing to. So I don't want to paint this like sort of like everything was bad and horrible, especially for like the people with younger kids who, you know, like I want to kind of give a little bit of hope too. And for all of you who don't have kids who might be like, oh, these are some ways that we can support folks as they like, you know, grow their families and then like, you know. So, as mentioned before, I co-founded Books Through Bars, and when I, like before, you know, I became a parent, and the people at Books Through Bars actually really wanted me to come back. They were like, when are you gonna come back? You know, like, we can schedule something around you. And then they were like, we can hold your baby while you do stuff. You know, like, we're willing to, like, you know, like, if your baby needs to be walked around the block, you know, so that she can, like, you know, like, settle down, that's fine. If you need us to put a blanket on the floor and, like, sit down and play with her, we could do that. You know, like, but we want you to be back in the group. We don't want to, like, you know, like, have you, like, not feel welcome. But we also don't want you to be there being like, I can't do anything, so what was the point of me being here? So, like, people really stepped up, you know, like, in terms of that. And as my daughter got older, they were willing to, like, step up in different ways. Like, when she was, you know, like, maybe, like, six, she didn't want to be in meetings anymore. You know, so, like, for, like, the big meetings where we'd make decisions, they'd say, okay, we will all kick in for the babysitter, right? So it's not coming out of funds used to send books to people in prison. It's not coming out of our general operating expenses. It will come out of our own pockets. You find somebody that you're comfortable with, so sticking you with somebody that you're not comfortable with, and we will pay that person, you know? And basically, like, this is how much we value your involvement, that we're willing to, like, do these kinds of things. Like, I've had other friends that were willing to either, like, leave an event early, you know, with my daughter, so that way I could stay later and enjoy myself, or work the event, or some combination thereof, or even skip what might be, like, the cool happening thing, you know, to babysit, you know, so that I would be able to participate. And then, like, on a more personal level, when my apartment got infested with toxic mold, you know, like, some friends from a punk house took us in. Now, those of you who know what punk houses are like, know that they really, like, usually aren't babysafe, right? They got stuff all over, they're kind of messy, sometimes they're kind of dirty. And they went through, and they cleaned up. You know, like, it's like messes stayed in people's rooms, they were totally fine. Oh, is there something we can do to help?
I think he wants to bring it out.
I'm like, that's fine. That's totally fine.
I guess to go back.
I'm like, that's fine. He can bring it out. You know, and so, and then after that too, like, so they were also fine with, like, if I needed to try to get something done, hanging out with my daughter. So, like, one time I came into the living room, and I found my daughter and somebody else, like, playing. And the person whose guitar it was, like, walked into the room, looked at her adult housemate, and was like, you need to be careful with my guitar. I don't care if the baby breaks my guitar. Like, you are an adult. Like, you need to, like, you know, like, take care of my guitar, you know? But, like, the baby can be like, you know? You know, and so, like, you know, like, those are the kinds of things that, like, you know, like, I was like, wow, this is what, you know, community should be like. So even if it's like my personal preference is to, like, be messy and be punk and be loud and have sharp objects lying around, but we're taking somebody in, you know, like, who can't live like this, you know, like, we are going to make this effort to clean up. Hey there again. You know, there's. Oh. Hello. And so one of the things that, like, I, you know, wanted to point out too is that the support I get shouldn't be exceptional. And in talking with other folks that have had kids again and again, it feels like, you know, like, it is. Like, they're not getting even, like, this, you know, like, the small things, like, we won't, like, you know, like, smoke at meetings, or we'll have these meetings in places that are conducive to having, you know, small children around, so that you can, you know, like, participate in the ways that you need to. And so I wanted to, like, kind of, like, pose this question of, like, what's happening with our movements, that we're not putting these theories of mutual aid and support and transforming the world into practice, you know, where we are right now. So now that I've, like, talked at you for a bit, you know, like, I wanted to, like, you know, like, throw out this idea, like, what are some ways that you think that you can support the families in your midst, you know, from where you're sitting or from the work that you're doing right now? Anybody?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hi,
I'm part of Anarchy in Action, and we just started a community garden down the street from here. And one of the things we did, and one of our goals from the beginning, was to have the children of the community to be involved as much as possible. And so we reserved plots for them, where they can come and grow and tend, and we'll be there to help them out. And then there's also a big old space right next to the garden that they've kind of just taken over as a soccer field and they use like that. And I think something like that of, you know, like, I don't have kids, I'm not family oriented at all, but it's like, I think if we're going to grow a community, like, that it has to be that way. Like, we have to account for families and small children and everything else like that. I think, I mean, that's one way that we've been doing that.
Other ways that people either have been or can think about, like, you know, being like, oh yeah, we could, you know, do this. Caregivers, anything that would be helpful if you're like, hey, when I come to an event, I would like, yeah.
One of the things that I do is urgent childcare. So it's like last minute childcare. If somebody can't take their child to daycare, I do it. I don't do it for free because I need to make a living, mm-hmm. but that's one of the things that I've implemented in one of my businesses is to help people out in that way, not to exasperate the cost or whatever the cost would be at their normal daycare. But sometimes the child gets a fever mm-hmm. and they have to wait 24-hour period before they return. So that's one of the things that I've incorporated. And I thought about that when I used to work, that was the main thing. And then at one point, the employers are like, how many fevers can a child have, you know? So when they're in daycare, they're liable to get a lot of bugs from other children. So that's one of the things that I thought about. One time I was traveling and my flight was delayed. It was a business trip. And the person who was taking care of my child, fortunately, at the last minute, her other activity that she had to take care of the next day was rescheduled. But otherwise, I would have been stuck. Like, I couldn't get on the plane. We were coming from Indiana. There was high winds, so they canceled all the flights. So that's another thing that made me think. We need to, when I lost my job, mm-hmm. I was like, I need to implement that. And that's what I do, you know, part-time. Supply people
for last-minute childcare. Other things folks can think of? Ways to support kids, families? Doesn't have to be events. Doesn't have to be a huge thing. Yeah?
It seems to me like planning can also always kind of incorporate like different levels of ability. I mean, not just being in terms of age, but just across the range of ability, cognitively and bodily, so that you're not sort of excluding anybody who, you know, certainly there may be actions and ways of participating that you don't want to take part in, but it seems possible in advance to make the available activities that people of different abilities approach the time can take part in.
Yeah. Like having multiple points of entry is like super important. Yeah. Everyone.
Well, I think in Europe they've socialized childcare, they make it free, and in America it's kind of like it's a low priority, you know,
yeah.
sometimes they leave. Mm-hmm. But it shouldn't be like that in the.
Hey there. Oh, you know, you forgot to.
I know there's like some ideas for childcare cooperatives where parents will like, you know, work together and exchange, you know, get free childcare in exchange for sort of working together and. Pulling the resources together.
I want to piggyback on that and also be like, it shouldn't always be on the parents. You know, like parent daycare cooperatives are great, but sometimes you're just like, I just want like a break. You know, like even if, especially if you have like a high needs kid or a high stress job or, you know, like some combination thereof, even if you're like, I did, you know, like I took that lady's kid and she just looked like she stared at the ceiling for 3 hours. It's kind of like sometimes people need that break, you know, like think about like, you know, but, you know, like, so this idea of like childcare cooperatives, but also maybe think about developing relationships with kids in which you're like, you know, either I'm doing something kid friendly, I'm going to the garden, you know, like, hey, does your kid want to come with me, which gives somebody a really needed break. And it's also like a, you know, like, hey, I'm doing something that's kid friendly. Like, I'm not going out and like, you know, like throwing things at the police, you know, which is not a kid-friendly activity. You know, like I'm going, you know, like I'm going to like go plant. You know, like I'm going to, you know, like I'm gonna go do this, you know, like do you wanna come? And it's also a way, like if you think about growing relationships or developing relationships, like as adults, we tend to develop relationships in like really adult places. Like, you know, like it's like you go to the lab party, you go to like the thing that starts late at night, you go to like the thing that's really like sit down and talky, you know, like, or you go to the bar, you know, like, so like if you think about like reshift how you form relationships so that it's also like, well, sometimes we go and we like, you know, like make food or like, hey, I'm gonna go like bake a cake, you know, do you think your kid, or bake cookies, you know, like, do you think your kid might wanna come and hang out with me while I do this, you know, type of thing, to like kind of reshift, you know, that idea too. So again, it's not always like the parents have to take care of other parents' kids in addition to, but also, like my daughter is now 12. So my daughter is like at the age where perhaps she's not necessarily going to want to talk to me about everything, right? She's like, oh, where's my mom? You know, and for me and for her, it's been really invaluable to have other folks that she's had relationships with since she was like the age of that, you know, like the staircase baby, you know, and Eliza, to like be like, oh, you know, like these are people that I also know and I trust. And hopefully when she has questions, she goes to them. And hopefully also they talk to her about things that she might be like thinking or seeing. So it's not always like, oh, my mom is talking to me again about what's wrong with Katy Perry's lyrics. It's just mom talk, you know, like, but then if other trusted adults are also like, hey, you know, like, don't you think there's something a little funky about like that song, you know, like, you know, yeah, it might have a catchy beat and all your friends listen to it, but, you know, and if it's coming from several other people, it's like, oh, wait, you know, like, maybe there is something to that. Or somebody might be like, hey, you know, I've been listening to this, you know, like, singer-songwriter who, like, is really awesome, you know, like, and is a woman of color and, you know, like, doesn't have misogynistic lyrics and, like, you know, like, what do you think of this? And it becomes really invaluable when it's not just, like, you know, like, the parents or the caregivers who are, like, talking about these issues. So, again, it's not just, like, of course my mom doesn't want me to listen to Katy Perry. Of course she doesn't want me to, you know, like, as opposed to like, oh, you know, somebody else I know and trust is talking about these issues, you know, like in like ways that might make me think more deeply about it than just like that's parental noise. I mean, for those of you who like maybe don't have tweens in your life, like think about when you were 12 and 13 and 14 and how much you really appreciated it when your parents tried to tell you anything about anything. You know, like it just doesn't, you know, it just kind of like doesn't, you know, work all that well. Other suggestions?
Yeah. Oh, mm-hmm. Well, it's a very simple thing, but it's something that I see coming up and I'm kind of trying to address is to even not sort of instinctively, without maybe quite knowing you do it, make that what's up with the noise from the kid, you know, just that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't even know how to put it into words because it seems like it is almost instinctive. Like, well, this is a kid-friendly place, but a kid throws something and people are like, whoa. You know, like, well, you can't have it both ways.
Yeah. Also, I think, like, you know, going back to my own days as, like, you know, like a mom with a small kid, and maybe you can, like, you know, corroborate if this, like, rings true with you since it's been quite a few years for me. You know, like, having somebody like smile or like, you know, like just say something encouraging, like if you've made that face and you're like, oh, you know, like, you know, be like, oh, you know, that's so cute. Or like, hey, yeah, you wanna, like, you know, like, so it's sort of like, okay, it's okay. Even if I like made that weird face, you know, like, you know, kind of like when you're like sitting in the library and somebody's like talking to themselves next to you and you're like, you know, like if I've made that face, it's like, then be like, oh wait, you know, I actually didn't mean to make that face. Like, let's, you know, like, hey, yeah, you threw that. Great, you know, like smile, you know, like, but something that I think puts people more at ease, because I feel like especially newer parents feel like really on the defensive, and they're like always like, am I doing this right? You know, you're in some sort of like subculture, you know, like you're being told from, you know, like the mainstream movement that like everything you do is wrong, right? You have not bought the right thing, you're not parenting the right way, you know, like, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Your kids don't look right, your kids don't act right. And then like to get that from your like subculture or your movement as well, even if it isn't like a deliberate intention to alienate people, is really like hurtful, and it tends to drive people out. So, you know, like the simple sort of like, oh, that's okay. Your kid made noise. Your kid is, you know, your kid is riding the tricycle. Like, oh, like, let's all, like, intervene. Like, somebody's not sitting back here, so the children will walk down the stairs. You know, like, so that that way, like, that can create something, like, a little more either safe or welcoming or both.
We always found it, we've gone to Minneapolis a number of times for various events, and every single time, no matter where it is or what the event is, there's always child care as a given. And it's so nice, and then, you know, that's not something that we have here. I don't know if it's because there aren't as many kids with the people that are going to the event, or like what, or maybe everybody has to keep them home, but that would be something that would be really great to see. We would love to do that here, but we don't have this space.
I think we are growing this space.
Yeah.
This is a great space, but when we have events with so many people, it's growing. I'm going to get six fans.
I think that gender binary is very detrimental to children, and in allowing for like gender non-conforming is something that's very important in these types of spaces.
Yeah. Wait, hold on a second. But can you like maybe like tease that out a little bit more as to what that would look like in terms of supporting folks?
Just like allowing, like instead of like separating boys from girls, like allowing them to have activities in the same space and do the same things.
Yeah.
And if like boys want to dress in a more feminine manner, then that should be totally fine.
Definitely. Yeah. And again, because they're not going to get that in the like normal mainstream places that they are, like they're going to be told like, no, boys don't wear, you know, sparkly shoes, and girls, you know, don't blah blah blah, you know, like, so it's really important in these spaces for people to also like be aware of that. You know, like, be like, okay, you know, like, if we're creating, like, alternatives to, like, you know, like, you know, like, you know, like, misogynist, racist, you know, like, patriarchal, like, you know, like, et cetera, society, like, we need to, like, figure out how are we addressing or not addressing or challenging, you know, these issues.
Yeah, I don't know, I think that is something that is being lost with the time. I am from a very small town, is the fact that children can also have the bubbles organized themselves and be participants in community, being the actors of those activities. I mean, I grew up in the street, playing in the street.
Mm-hmm.
Not like something that is lost. Children don't play so much in the street when adults are not there, you know what I mean? So we were children organizing activities for our own benefits,
mm-hmm,
and telling to adults, hey, we want to do that. Can you help us in this situation, and we will raise money, for example, for whatever we wanted. But it was activity of children, made for children,
mm-hmm,
with an objective that was creating among us. And something that I don't see now, I mean, my niece and my nephew, they don't do those kind of activities. They don't play so much in the streets. And for sure, they don't develop all those skills to create community among them and to take decisions for themselves, what they want and how they can organize themselves alone, you know, without adults to organize.
Mm-hmm.
And something that made me think a lot in terms of how much power we take away, power of the children we,
mm-hmm,
took away. So I don't know, it's something, listening to you in the ways that we are portraying against children, in this idea of caring children,
mm-hmm,
we are lost in the conversation about the power of children,
yeah,
to decide and to organize themselves without adults.
Oh, definitely, you know, and I think one of the things that's really important, you know, is like having that space. And I don't know about Buffalo, but like in New York, like kids don't play in the street until they're a certain age, for the most part, right? Like some people, like, you know, like don't have the like resources or whatever to be able to keep their kids home. But like in New York, there's a lot of like, you know, like you stay in your apartment or you stay in your, like, you know, like, as opposed to like kids being able to like run around in the streets, you know, like, and be able to like play with each other. There's a lot of like individual houses, which then doesn't make for like building community either, like of like, you know, of any ages, you know. And then you go to school, and school is very regimented,
yeah.
And then, you know, so like maybe having those kinds of spaces where like kids can get together and get to know each other, and then be like, well, what do you want to do? Oh, we should do this. Okay, well, what do you suggest? You know, like, but having that free space and free time to be able to do that. Other?
I have some things recently. I don't have my own kid. Kids are very different. It also depends on how they grow in the family. So one of my friends who has a kid, a two-year-old, she eats all the time iPad or iPhone or camera. Mm-hmm. She can't go beyond that. And if you take her into a space where people can, you know, kids are playing, she just keeps up to herself. You know, even you try, even if your parents try. But I see my other friend, whose kid is all the time just like bikes playing with other people, has nothing to do with camera or iPad, mm-hmm. or, you know, likes reading books, like watching, you know, a little bit of cartoon. Mm-hmm. But it also like depends on the parents, you know, how you really push your like kid to make their own community or develop that skill so that they can interact with the community. So I don't know like how I've seen, there was one point of time when I was living in India, I, you know, there were people, neighbors around who wanted to go for a movie, and we all had like, I used to take care of like five kids. There was no babysitting or anything. It was just understood that if she is going, I have to take care of the kid. So that kind of relationship we had. So that was the community, strong community. She had no fear in asking, or even I didn't have even offer, you know, I would just go. So I don't see that very much now, even in India. It's a lot of very individual, you know, quite individual. People have developed that kind of sense. So my younger, like now I see my niece and nieces, they are not allowed to do that. They don't stay with anybody. It's all about me, you know, like, oh, stay with here, don't go here, you know. So I it's just hard to see the community feeling kids these days. So I don't know, when she talked about power, like we organized the same way when we were younger. But not, I don't see many, and I would say like part of it is the parents and the parents to help
those, you know. I mean, I think it's really hard, you know, like as parents. So like, you know, like, so I've seen a lot of parents, like, you know, like, especially those who like have devices, be like, it's really easy to get through a meeting or something else if you can give your kid a device, right? And the kid is like, especially when they're like really little, like once my daughter started reading, it's like whole worlds opened up to us. Cause it's like, then I could go and I could go to an event and she would sit there with her book. But when she was like, you know, staircase kid's age and like Eliza's age, it was like constantly like, I've got to run after her, maybe she's making too much noise, maybe too many people gave me the stink eye, I feel like I've got to leave, you know, maybe she's walking out the door, you know, so like I feel like the device has become that thing that like pre-literate kids, you know, or kids that aren't really into reading are doing, but like maybe one of the things that people can do is like offer an alternative, you know, which the kid may not take you up on, but like rather than be like, hey parent, you know, like, because I feel like parents again like sometimes take criticism like really, really personally, but be like, hey, you know, like I was wondering if I could like, you know, like take your kid out to this thing and can they leave their device at home, you know, like, you know, like, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes a kid is just like, I don't want to leave my device at home, you know, like I must, you know, like go with my device. One of the things that really kind of broke my heart, one of my daughter's good friends got a Kindle, you know, which, you know, like can be used for reading, but also can be used for games. And they used to like go to museums all the time. And like they, as long as they were in the same floor, the same room as us, we would be able to like, you know, like her mom and I would look at stuff and the girls would walk around and look at stuff and talk about whatever they talked about, you know, in terms of what they were looking at or maybe they weren't talking about it at all. But then once her friend got this device, she just basically wanted to like be on her device. And I'd be like, hey, we're at a museum. Why can't we, you know? So like, you know, like, and so one of the things, like, I think like we started being like, just like, hey, like if we go to this, can your daughter not bring her device? And sometimes, you know, like the, you know, her friend would be like, actually, I don't want to go to a museum today. I'd rather just hang out, you know, with you alone, you know, like at one of our houses and play on this device, you know, like, so again, it's kind of like that, like being like, okay, like here's an alternative. Like we could go to this thing, but we would like her to not have this, you know, like thing. Like, you know, like on all the time. So it's like ding, ding, ding. And it's like, but look at everything around you. And they're like, no, because I actually asked afterwards, I was like, what did you like best about the museum? And my daughter was like, oh, like, you know, like I was really struck by this, you know, and like, and her friend was like, you know, when I was doing this game on my Kindle, you know, like I was really sad when I was like, hey. But again, like, I feel like if you offer like an alternative, you know, like the kid may not take you up on it. Like, it might just be like, no, I just want to like, glued to my screen, but like offer that alternative, instead of like, you know, like a criticism, so that way parents don't think, oh my God, you know, like I somehow failed the like, you know, like social justice parent fitness test. And hopefully, like as like weather gets nicer and other things happen, like the kid will be like, yeah, maybe I do want to go outside and like be. You had your hands up, or
oh no,
okay,
gender expressive.
What are some other ways you can think of to support?
I helped coordinate the initiative of games track at the Unedited conference. I'm really psyched about this year because we really kind of had to go out of our way to make this happen because it meant that we were flying two people from California to Detroit fundraising. But there was a woman who proposed a session of game design for kids that she's facilitating with her son, who's 10, which is like, and she was like, I understand if you can only fly one of us, and we're like, no, like, we think your son already does this. And like this, I guess, sort of also talks to the device issue, right? Is that like, there's a level beyond media consumption that is available to kids. And like, a lot of people don't realize that like, things like computer programming can actually be made accessible. I guess that's like a sort of like instance where like a parent who is involved in something like game design already has like been opening that as like an opportunity for her son and also her son's friends. But like I think especially those of us with specialized technical knowledge like that, that's like really exciting to kids. Like we don't always think that that's something that a kid might be interested in or something we could teach a kid, but it's like clearly interesting to them because what kid doesn't like video games? They're very native though.
Other suggestions? Yeah.
Well, earlier we were talking about kind of like, you know, collective or like mutual like sharing of childcare in the community. I think, you know, there might be people in the community who maybe don't have the highest confidence about their child caring skills or knowledge. So like I, you know, be worried about babies around myself. So like just expanding the number of people who, you know, are comfortable and confident providing child care in the community and that can therefore make themselves available as support in that way, like growing the number of people that can help out with parenting responsibilities and things like that.
Yeah. Like, there are a couple of different things. Like, one thing my coordinator Ken and I always joke about and we never do is like, we always are like, we should propose how to hold a baby.
Yeah.
You know, like, people are like, oh, baby what? You know,
like,
But you know, like, also it's like, you know, like spending time with, you know, like folks with kids, so it doesn't necessarily have to be like, I'm taking your kid immediately. You know, or also the parent or caregiver might be like, no, I don't really know you, but you know, like, hey, you know, like, I'm doing this thing, you know, like, and you spend time with kids, and so, like, Josh said earlier, like, I'm involved with a community art center called BBC in Rio, and, like, every couple of years, we do this, like, huge building-wide show, which, like, has, like, hundreds of artists, and, like, every, like, nook and cranny of the building is, like, filled with art. It is the hugest headache, you know, to like organize, right? Because every artist wants to come in, and then they want the space, and then they want this. But you know, and like basically, like you know, sort of like parenting, like presence, kind of goes out the window. It's kind of like, okay, you're in the building, and you're kind of left to your own devices. And what my daughter does is she'll go up and she'll like find artists that are like doing something interesting, and she just ask them questions and ask them questions and ask them questions. And sometimes they're really cool and they're like, oh, do you want to help? Or, okay, do you want to do this? And one artist actually said one time that those questions helped her clarify what she wanted to do. Because she's like, oh, I was thinking of putting this up. And my daughter was like, why would you do that? thought about it. And I was like, you know, just because I have this piece of material doesn't mean it needs to go into my like art piece. You know, but it's kind of like, so even though like I don't know what other people, what these artists like, interactions with children had been previously, like, you know, like, just sort of, like, being able to, like, spend time to be like, hey, I'm doing this thing, and this kid is wandering over and asking me lots of questions, like, what are you gonna do with all those ribbons? And why are they red? And, you know, like, and what are you gonna do with that? And then why are you doing that? And wait, what does that do? And what does that mean? You know, like, does that mean something? You know, like, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And, like, later on, she was actually able to give this whole explanation about this piece. The only thing I knew about it was like, this artist needs to come in Tuesday at 3, you know, like, and they need this, and they, you know, like, but I don't remember what the like motivation behind that work is. You know, I'm just like, okay, whatever, you're here at 3, you need to be out of here at this time so people can like walk through here, and you know. And she was like, oh, I can talk about all this because somebody actually didn't just kind of shunt me off and be like, kid, I'm busy, go away, you know, like, or was really terse, but they were actually like, okay, I'll explain what I'm doing as I go along. And a couple of artists were like, yeah, I really like hanging out with you. You know, and then I think that there were probably some people who were like, why does this kid keep asking me questions? You know, and for those people, it's kind of like she probably just wanders off and is like, yeah, this person kind of sucks.
I was just thinking, I never really fully thought out this idea, but I'm thinking like with the work that I'm trying to get into and kind of how the suspension and expulsion of children basically from our school systems and the school to prison pipeline, how as a community could we kind of work to make sure that kids that say are suspended from school on a day, you know, that's the first time that perhaps they've been away from school, now they're in the neighborhood, the parents are at work, you know, how could we kind of set up some kind of a program where kids have somewhere to go during the day for kids that are suspended, because some of these kids are, you know, having sex for the first time, doing drugs for the first time, selling drugs for the first time, you know, when they're suspended. And, you know, it's a purposeful system that's getting them out of the schools. So how can we act preemptively to set up a program that reacts to that? And I'm not sure what the answer is, but I think, you know, kind of maybe hooking up with groups that are already doing fun activities that kids enjoy, like drum circles, step teams, and things like that, so that they would have something available during the weekdays, which I don't think is going on right now.
Other things?
Well, one of the serious human rights abuses in the United States concerns children. It's, when children are tried as adults in prison, that's illegal internationally, and it's serious human rights abuse. And, the U.S. chose not to ratify the Convention on the Rights of the Child, just so it could perpetuate that human rights abuse. And, I mean, that's a major thing to try to call for, is that ratification. So children have rights like everyone else.
Other ways? Yeah.
Just like most of the organizing meetings I go to, like, it seems like if there is any food or drink, it's always, like, coffee and maybe soda. And, like, I don't know, like, when I was a kid, I would not drink coffee and, like, soda. And, like, soda is good. Like, I love soda when I'm a kid, but, like, most parents would be like, oh, no, no, no. And you'd be, like, all over the walls. So maybe just, like, thinking of kid-friendly juices and stuff.
No, I mean, that's an awesome, you know, sort of like, and it's something that's really easy. It's not like a, you know, but yes, like, you know, like keep it accessible and keep finding foods and drinks. Definitely. Other ways that you can think of to just make events?
Yeah, I think that, like, that brings up a good point, and another good way for people who aren't, like, super comfortable with kids to get involved is just, like, having kids means, like, a lot of prep work. Like, it takes forever just, like, to get out the door, you know? And so, you know, just like maybe, like you said, like providing snacks, you know, so that you know that wherever you're bringing your kid, there's going to be like healthy snacks there. Like a quiet place if you need to go like breastfeed, you know, just some of those like little prep work things, and you could like pitch in and do that. I think that that would make, you know, a big difference for the overall experience for parents.
Right, and I don't know if this has been mentioned before, but putting it on the flyer that there will be childcare, there'll be a kid's activity, so that parents know that it's like, okay, I'm going to go to this thing and then there's going to be an art activity in another room. Seems like a way we can have all these things, but if we don't let parents know that they're going to be available, probably people will assume that it's not there.
No. You know, like that is definitely a good point. It's like, we often assume that there is no, you know, nothing for kids to do, so we don't bother, you know.
Yeah, I'm piggybacking on that. Also, tell us that it's not kids friendly. That would be important. There was an event that was posted on Facebook that I assumed that when we kid friendly, because it's like kind of like in a bar. And so that means the person get a joke and say, "Come," as long as the children are not ordering from the bar.
Uh-huh.
But just to tell people, if it's not, they said, I feel it's someone that knows of me, sees me over the children, but just if it's not friendly, then we need to know that too, because how would I know? Other than I can't go because it's at a bar.
This is sort of a little thing. One of the first things that I had to learn when I started working with young people is that it's okay to treat them kind of like adults sometimes, and when they ask questions, to give them real answers. Which is like something that I didn't really get growing up, and so I, like, when they ask what the sun is made out of, you're like, I don't know, fire. Instead of saying, you know, the real things, and asking kids questions instead of their parents' questions, mm-hmm. you know, talking to them as if they're actual people. Mm-hmm.
Other suggestions? So I don't know if this will work, because I don't know how many of you in the room already know each other, or like if this is, you know, but I wanted to kind of like give us a short break from like being on the app and like see about building community. And again, it's my fault flat if this is a small community that folks know each other. But try to find somebody in the room that you either don't already know or don't know well. Introduce yourself, or reintroduce yourself, and spend a couple of minutes just talking about whatever, you know, like, you know, brings you to the event, what you do, what your day is like, whatever. You know, just to kind of like build a little off this. So go.
A lot of people have come in since I made the first announcement, so I'm going to pass the basket again. Like I said, if you want to do events like this at Burning Books, well, they're great, but we need to get a little bit of money together to do it. So please, whatever you've got, and if you know, if you don't have any, don't worry about it. Consider put a book on your credit card or something. Here we go. We're going to send that around again. Put in whatever you have and enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. So this is the second part of the presentation, which focuses more on people in women's prisons and resistance and organizing in women's prisons, which I suspect a lot of you came out for. So I want to start with a startling statistic, which is in 2012, there were over 200,000 people in women's jails and prisons. So 200,000, mostly women, behind bars. This number does not include women in immigrant detention centers, and it doesn't include trans women in men's jails or prisons. So the number is actually much higher than that. So again, kind of to make it a little bit more participatory, what do you think about when you think about women in prison? What are some issues that come to mind? Anybody want to? Yeah?
Forced sterilization.
Forced sterilization is huge and often not necessarily like visible, seen, or like, you know, like noticed or recognized. So, you know, like women in different prison systems, California right now is like mounting advocates in California, not the state government of California, is like mounting an investigation and trying to stop the forced sterilization of women in the prison system. So women will go in to have some sort of other healthcare procedure and be sterilized, you know, in addition to the healthcare procedure. And I'm sure that this happens in other places. Which also ties into like this idea of like reproductive justice, like, to like have and take care of and raise your own children. So if we think about forced sterilization, we also have to think about how prisons themselves and the long prison terms women are given during most of their reproductive years is also another form of sterilization that just is not medically, you know, invasive. Other issues?
How the expansion of women's prisons is often talked about as a positive reform for prisons, but that it creates more beds that the prison system always finds a way to fill.
Yes, yes. Like there have been a lot of talks about gender-responsive prisons, you know, like instead of like looking at like why are we sending so many, you know, women to prison in the first place.
Overcrowdedness. My sister's serving in prison, and a prison is supposed to be 500. It's like 890.
Yes.
So it's very. She has a 6x10 room. She bumped two other people, three in the room. Oh, yes, though.
Yeah. So prisons are also overcrowded. Like all prisons, you know, like suffer from, or most prisons suffer from overcrowding, whether they be men's prisons or women's prisons. But you know, like the overcrowding is often used then as an excuse to then build more prisons, as opposed to saying like, why are we sending so many people to prisons for, you know, like these reasons, you know, or you know, instead of, say, looking at, like, what some of the root causes are for sending, you know, for sending people to prison. Yeah?
That is sexual violence in prisons?
There is a lot of sexual violence in prison. I am not going to be graphic. I would request other people not to be graphic because there are kids in their room and we also don't know, like, what other people have experienced, you know, but there's, like, all sorts of sexual violence from, like, out and out, you know, like, sexual assault to, you know, like, the things, like, being watched, you know, like, by, you know, like, while you're doing things like dressing, undressing, you know, like, being on the toilet, being in the shower, you know, like, in so many women's prisons, you know, like, they're guarded by people of all genders, and it is not uncommon in women's prisons for a male guard to be able to, like, watch a woman while she's, you know, like, in some sort of state of undress, because it's his job. And it's only in the states like Michigan and New York where women have sued and won have they been able to keep male guards out of certain areas or during certain times, like, you know, like during the night when, like, people are most vulnerable to being assaulted, you know, or molested without any witnesses, or out of certain areas in which they're more vulnerable to that. Other things that come to mind when you think of women in prison? What other issues come to mind?
Having their babies taken away at birth when part or I'm not sure when that happens, that whole situation.
Yes. Approximately 6 to 10% of people entering women's jails and prisons enter pregnant every year. Most of them spend the duration of their pregnancy in jails and prisons. And unless that jail or that prison has a nursery program, which is very rare, and then if that person qualifies, like, i.e. they, like, bite their tongue, they don't, you know, file any grievances or complaints against the prison system. In some prison systems, it's if you happen to not be African American as well, then maybe you qualify for that prison nursery program in which you can keep your baby with you for, like, 6, 12, or 18 months. But if you don't have a nursery system or a nursery program in, you know, the place where you're going to be staying, if you somehow don't qualify because you've, like, filed grievances or, you know, like, or because you happen to be the wrong race or you've pissed someone off, then your baby gets, you get, like, your pregnancy to figure out where you're going to place the baby, and then the baby is taken to you, from you between 24 and 72 hours after giving birth. And how many of you know about this Federal Adoption and Safe Families Act?
About what?
The Adoption and Safe Families Act. So the Adoption and Safe Families Act was passed in 1997 by Congress, and it basically was this act that would, quote unquote, free children in foster care for adoption. So what they were saying is, like, you know, like, these parents aren't getting it together, you know, like, they should, like, they shouldn't be able to keep their kids in foster care, you know, while they, like, don't get their acts together, instead of looking at all the barriers that cause people to not be able to, you know, get their children out of the foster care system. And so it said that if a child has been in foster care for 15 of the past 22 months, the state and the child welfare offices have to start proceedings to terminate parental rights. Mm-hmm. And at the time of its drafting, only 2 states enacted it with an exception for incarcerated parents. So they were like, well, the exception to this timeline would be if it's because the parents are incarcerated. But that meant there were 48 other states in which there was a ticking timeline. And in New York State, for instance, the average sentence for a woman in prison is 36 months. So if your child is in foster care, the minute you enter, you get arrested and you enter, like, the, you know, like, the legal system, then your clock is ticking and most likely your child will be, quote unquote, freed for adoption. One interesting fact to note is that this 15 months isn't actually based on any sort of child psychology either. It's one part of Congress, and I forget which, either the House or the Senate wanted it to be 12 months and the other one wanted it to be 18 months, and 15 months was their compromise solution. You know, and instead, of course, you know, like, people swooping down to adopt all these newly freed children in the foster care system, basically kids languished in the foster care system until they aged out. And once they aged out, they didn't have any sort of support. They didn't have any institutional support. They had no familial support. And terminating parental rights means that you have no right to know anything about where your kid is. So once your parental rights are terminated, you can't then say, like, you know, like, well, wait, I want to, like, be able to write to my child. I want to be able to call my child or send them a birthday card, because you have no more rights to, like, knowing anything about that child than the stranger in the grocery store. In 2010, so that's 13 years, I think, after the Federal Adoption and Safe Families Act passed, New York State became the third state to pass some sort of exception for incarcerated parents. So like again, 13 years later, so like it was a ton of organizing and activism by people who had been directly affected by this, you know, like by this act, or you know, like might have been affected by this act, and they were the third state. And then this past May, Washington State became the fourth state again, because there was this groundswelling of organizing from parents who had been affected, you know, like by both incarceration and the foster care system, to say like, hey, we need to make these exceptions because there are huge barriers to trying to even find out where your child is when you're incarcerated. Whether it's, you know, like you're trying to call the foster care agency or the foster care parents and they are not accepting your collect phone calls, you know, to I need to write a letter to the judge and I don't have any envelopes and I can't get an envelope, you know, or I'm supposed to show up in court, but the prison or the jail is not going to transport me to the court to show up to, you know, hearings. So again, like they did all this on the ground work to like to lay out like why, you know, like incarcerated parents have such a hard time even showing up to these states and quote unquote maintaining contact with their child. But yeah, so you know, like so there's children getting taken away when they're babies, and then there's also like children who've, you know, already been born going through that foster care system and parents tending to being at risk of losing them. And when we look at the way parenting is gendered in society, when a father goes to prison, most likely, not all the time, but most likely he's got somebody in his family or in his circle that will take care of his children. Most likely a female person. You know, like his mom, you know, like his girlfriend, his wife, his ex-girlfriend, you know, his sister, his cousin. Somebody will step up and make sure that child is taken care of, you know, and they don't enter the foster care system. When a mother goes to prison, her child is 5 times more likely to end up in the foster care system because she doesn't have that same sort of familial support. And there's not that ingrained societal idea that you need to step up and, you know, like help a woman take care of her children. If a mom goes to prison, it's like, you're a bad mom, you shouldn't have gone to prison. You know, why should we step up and take care of you? Why are you doing this? So there's a lot more stigma attached to this, and there's a lot more reluctance, you know, like for people to step up and help take care of her child while she's inside. Other things that come to mind?
I don't know all the details, but I'm imagining people who are transgendered have a worse and largely ignored plight in prison, and I sort of
trans people like have a huge, you know, like have huge amounts of issues, problems. So like in addition to like a lot of these concerns that like, you know, like we're kind of hopefully gonna go through, like there's also the fact that when you were trans, oftentimes you're placed in a prison that is not your preferred gender. So most prisons place people based on their either gender assigned at birth or on their genitalia. So like right then and there you're placed, you know, like so if you are a trans woman, you're placed in a men's prison. If you're a trans man, you're placed in a women's prison. You're subject to like a lot of violence, both from staff and from the people around you. The staff doesn't do anything to like deal with this violence, you know, against you. Or taking medications or hormones, a lot of times the prison system won't continue them. Or they'll say, because you didn't have a legal prescription for these hormones, like we then won't continue these hormones. So a couple of states have actually enacted that if you were taking prescribed hormones before you entered the prison system, we will continue them. But for a lot of low-income trans people who end up, you know, getting caught up in the net and getting sent to prison, they didn't necessarily have a legal prescription for hormones. They were getting them, you know, in an extra legal way. So then they can't prove, like, well, I had this prescription from Dr. X, Y, and Z, so this is why we can continue this. And stopping, you know, like hormone therapy, like abruptly, has huge medical and psychological, you know, effects on people. So those are a couple of things to kind of like touch on. Like when we, and then in addition to like all the other things that you have to put up with in prison.
Bodily and mental health care, everyone is thinking.
Yes. Yeah, healthcare is horrendous in prison. You know, healthcare on the outside if you're low income is also not super great. You know, but like, you know, like I mean, to top it off, if you are in a women's prisons often don't have female specific healthcare. You know, so like they might not necessarily have, you know, like resources to deal with you if you're pregnant, or might not necessarily be willing to put resources in. So like if you're pregnant and you'd say need, you know, extra vitamins and extra food, they'll be like, here's an apple. That is your extra snack. You know, like, oh, you need vitamins. Well, too bad, so sad, or go buy the vitamins. You know, like, you know, if you have, you know, a family history of like breast cancer or cervical cancer, oftentimes prisons don't, you know, do any sort of preventative care like screening, so they definitely, once you get cancer, you have to fight them tooth and nail to be able to get treatment for having these cancers. Gynecological services are either, you know, like, are either negligent or, you know, like, abusive at times. Like, there was, you know, like, one instance in California where a doctor was performing really invasive, unnecessary, you know, examinations, you know, yeah. I'm trying to, like, be very mindful of the fact that they're children. And when he was actually questioned, he was like, well, women like this because this is the only male contact that they get, you know? It's like, so you go in and you're like, I have a headache, or I have a this, I have a that, and like, you don't necessarily want to see this person probing you in really sexually inappropriate ways. So like, you know, like, so your gynecological services might also be so invasive that you're like, I actually need gynecological care, thank you very much. You know, not for you. And then also, women in prison tend to enter prison HIV positive more often than either men in prison or their female counterparts on the outside. And HIV/AIDS care is like, unless you're, say, at Bedford Hills in New York, like, you are not going to get very good, you know, care for yourself in prison.
It can be very dangerous to someone that has a drug or alcohol dependency to be put in prison, and the effects of going cold turkey could put their life in danger. And actually, the way the prison system handles a medical condition like drug dependency, when someone should be in a hospital, not being put in prison for a medical condition.
Well, also we have to remember too that there's a huge number of people in prison because we have this war on drugs. You know, so in 2010, more than a quarter of women in state prison were incarcerated for a drug law violation. That's just like the outright drug law violation, not like, you know, like actions related to, like, you know, drug dependency or like substance abuse problems. And then more than half of women in federal prison were incarcerated for a drug law violation that year. So considering that, like, you know, like, there are over 200,000 women behind bars, you like start looking at those numbers and you're like, wait, you know. So our war on drugs has caused this many people directly to enter prison, and then indirectly, you know, caused this many more people to enter prison, instead of, say, looking at, like, what are some of the reasons why people are, you know, like, using drugs and illegal substances. Other things that come to mind?
I was thinking, you know, not only sort of physical health care, but also mental health care. You know, so going into prison, obviously, being in various forms of confinement, depression, anxiety, all of these other sort of psychological and very sort of bodily and affective sorts of illnesses that arise because of the incarceration also get a lot of attention.
Yes. No, mental health is like a huge issue in prison. And I don't know so much about in men's prisons, but in women's prisons, mental health is often dealt with psych meds. You know, like, and varying degrees of psych meds, and with women not necessarily being told what psych meds they're getting, you know, what psych meds they're not getting, you know, like, what the side effects might be, what, you know, like, and then they're also taking on and off psych meds, candy or something. It's like, instead of, like, looking at, like, well, if you start somebody on this, and then you abruptly stop them and switch them to something else, like, there are impacts, in addition to the fact that you are locked into, like, you know, like a small box or a dormitory with, like, you know, and you're continually monitored, and there are all these other issues. But so mental health is a huge issue, and then mental health care tends to be fairly abominable.
Mm-hmm. I don't know in this country, but it is where I am from. Even now, I am in democracy. Women who go into, because political issues or activism, are going into a lot of torture, psychological and physical torture. So that has been something that in this moment we are trying to think strongly about that. We saw we overcome that after democracy came back, but I am from Chile. But it looks like we still have this practice from the police specifically with women who go to prison in cases of who are activism with indigenous in this moment. And they are going to jail because of that, mostly indigenous women. They are speaking out that they have been suffering a lot of torture inside of the physical and psychological torture. in the prisons.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Can you repeat the question? I don't know how that works here.
I don't know if, I mean, like, people have, like, I know that there have been, like, many accounts of psychological torture, you know, like, in men's and women's prisons, you know, like, one of which is, like, you know, like, this, like, idea of indefinite solitary confinement, where you're stuck in your little box, you know, like, indefinitely, and the walls are even, like, either painted pure white or they're poured concrete, so you don't even have a texture to look at, like, it's just, like, a smooth wall, and people have been, like, locked up there for, like, you know, like, months, years, and decades on end, and some people have, like, started hallucinating things, you know, like, you're not allowed to talk, you know, like, you're not allowed to talk to yourself, even, in some cases, because you could actually be penalized even more for, you know, like, trying to just keep your sanity. So there's, like, that form of psychological torture. There's the fact that, like, you know, like, when you lock people up, you know, under these hard conditions, that's also a form of psychological torture, and then there's also a lot of violence, you know, both, you know, like, instituted by staff members, in which, like, you know, whether it be, like, physical violence, like, you didn't do something, and you, like, angered someone, and they beat you up, you know, like, or, in some cases, they do, if this gets to be a little much, just tell me to tone it down, you know, like, with what they call cell extractions, where, like, four or five armed guards will, like, go into a woman's cell and, like, physically remove her in a really violent way. And, like, sometimes they, like, use things like tear gas or pepper spray in addition to, like, you know, like, four or five armed... Usually it's, like, in the women's prisons they talk about armed men, like, big, burly men, like, going to, like, remove a woman from her cell because she's been, like, mouthing off or because she's somehow, like, you know, annoyed them. You know, like, and so it's a form of, like, physical torture and punishment, you know, like, where, like, they, like, take her, they, like, throw her on the floor, they, like, beat her up, they, you know, like, and then they haul her off to someplace else, you know, with pepper spray and everything else, you know, still on her clothes. So there's that kind of, and then there's also, like, the various forms of, like, sexual and mental violence that are inflicted from being in prison. Other things that come to mind?
Related to, like, torture, like, I'm not sure how many states still do it, but the shackling of women during labor?
Yes. So for those of you who don't know what shackling looks like, you know, like, think back to, like, all those black and white movies of chain gangs. So shackling is when a person is handcuffed, like this, and then they have a chain that goes around their belly, and then another chain that goes down to their ankles. And in New York State, they also put something called a black box around your hands, and your hands are like that. The chain is about as heavy as a bicycle chain. And these chains are used if you're pregnant. And in 31 states, if you are actively in labor and being transported to the hospital and about to give birth, or during postpartum recovery, you're still shackled and taken to the hospital like this, you know, like, in labor with this huge chain. And in most states, it is not up to the medical staff on duty to say, like, those need to come off because, you know, like, she's ready to push and the baby's coming. It's up to the staff member, the prison staff member that comes with the woman in labor. So if the prison guard is like, I want to go smoke a cigarette outside and I want to go get a soda, then those chains don't come off until, like, that person is then ready. And there have been numerous accounts in which women have said, you know, like, the doctor, you know, God bless him, was about to get into a fist fight with the guard because those chains needed to come off right that instant. And he had to, so instead of, like, dealing with his patient, who is this woman in labor, he's yelling at the guard, you know, like, you need to take the chains off, you need to take the chains off, you know, like, what can I do to get you to take the chains off? And there are only 19 states that have any sort of protection for women who are in labor, delivery, or postpartum recovery against this. You know, this is only for, like, these, like, the small amount of time, never mind if you are, like, you know, not actively in labor, you're still transported anytime you, like, leave the jail or the prison, you know, to say go to the court date, to go to the hospital, you know, anything else like this. So that is a huge issue that affects, you know, so many people inside women's prisons. And the 19 states that have passed some sort of legislative legal protection around shackling or against shackling have not done so because somebody had a light bulb moment, but because people on the ground, hey, you need to, you know, we need to stop this barbaric practice. New York State passed its anti-shackling legislation in 2009 after years of groundwork from formerly incarcerated women who spoke about their experiences, like, in advocates who were like, hey, we need to do something about about this. And one of the things that they did was they partnered up, so it wasn't advocates doing, you know, it on their own without the expertise and experience, but also formerly incarcerated women being at that table to say, like, okay, we don't know how to write a bill. How do we write a bill? You know, like, in the advocates being like, we know how to write the bill. And then they're saying, like, what can we do to get the governor to sign this bill? We'll have a rally. So the first time they had a rally, everybody sat outside the governor's office in Midtown Manhattan, and they had signs, and they had posters, and they had flyers. And for those of you who have been to New York City, then like Midtown Manhattan, like, you know, sort of like, you know, Times Square, Sixth Avenue, like kind of the hub of that, people are really busy all the time. And there's always somebody trying to give you stuff. Usually it's like, you know, like a flyer for Subway or something else, you know, like, but somebody's trying to give you something. So you don't necessarily stop and take things and, like, you know, like, look and be like, hey, what's going on? So they were like, yeah, we had some press comms, some women talked about their experiences, but we don't feel like we really galvanized the general public into action. So what are we missing? And the formerly incarcerated women were like, well, I don't think anybody knows what that looks like. Let's do another one, and let's have a visual this time. Let's have people with those big fake pregnant bellies and chains sit down on the sidewalk. And then the formerly incarcerated women said, well, those of us who have been through this are never going through this again. Like, not even for, like, theater, not even to get this bill passed. So will you, people who have never experienced prison, be willing to dress up in these fake bellies and put on, like, these, you know, shackles and, like, this, like, you know, like, fake prison uniform and go sit there and be, like, the pops? And the other people said yes. And so then they had their rally, and people would be like walking to wherever they're walking, and they'd be like, what the? Because they would just see a line of pregnant women in chains, and then somebody would hand them a flyer, and somebody would talk about, like, you know, the impending legislation, and they'd be like, could you please call the governor and, you know, like, ask him to sign this bill? You know, like, we have a chance to, like, stop this egregious practice. Please call. And by the end of the day, the governor came out and was like, okay, I'll sign a bill. You know, please just, like, kind of get off my sidewalk. It's great, you know, like, I'll sign this, you got it, you know. So, again, this was, like, a, you know, like, collaborative effort, so it wasn't people, you know, like, doing this without the input, you know, and experience of people who actually experienced it. You know, and they came to the table and they were like, this is what we think needs to happen as well. But yes, so, and in 2009, New York State was only the seventh state to have any sort of protection against shackling. And now we're up to, like, 19 states have protection, but that means we still have 31 states that still, like, are just kind of like, yes, this is a perfectly okay thing to do, you know? Because, you know, like, they're in prison, why not? Other things that come to mind? Can you think of women?
The travel, especially with women in prisons being not as, they don't have a lot of them. When my sister was sentenced, they said she would be no more than 400 miles away. And they put her in West Virginia, which is from here, which is 380 miles away. So, and then she has children who are not able to see remotely frequent. We haven't gone there yet because it's just so far and having to coordinate the expense of going there and where we'd stay, because we wouldn't want to just do one a round trip. We have to stay over. So that is, like, tough on women. And she's not the only one, of course. People are from all states to that federal prison.
Yeah.
So it's, like, unfortunate. It's, like, it had to be a federal charge because there's so many state prisons for women here, like, within a couple of hours. And she's so far because it was a federal charge.
Yeah. And even a lot of states, there's one or maybe two women's prisons, and they're still really far away. Mm-hmm. So even, like, in California, which incarcerates a huge number of women, you know, like, the women's prisons tend to be, like, not near any of the urban areas where a lot of, you know, like, where a lot of people originally come from and where their families and their communities are. So it's a huge hassle and a huge expense to, like, try to get to visit somebody inside.
It's like if we're doing activism, charter a bus and a group of us go together, say, to Albany. Do people do that to go and visit their friends in prison? Do they, like, charter a busload of people in Northern California to go to this?
There are a couple of groups that do, like, you know, like, prison bus services, you know, like, but it's, like, again, like, it shouldn't be that, like, you know, like, you have to, you know, people on the outside, which is great because it is one way that people can, like, concretely be like, I can use what resources I have and, say, charter a bus so that, like, 50 kids, you know, can go visit their parents in prison. you know, this weekend. That's awesome, you know, because it makes a concrete difference, you know, in people's lives. But there aren't like, you know, like, it's not like a state, you know, organized thing where like, we appreciate the child bond to, you know, to bring children to visit their parents while they're in prison. Other issues that come to mind?
Residual damage, you know, like not qualifying for public housing or...
Yes.
You know, the very few social safety nets there are.
Yes.
You know, mm-hmm. and especially with women being disproportionately...
Poor.
Poor.
Yes.
They're like... Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Shanta a few times then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, under, since you brought that up, under Clinton's 1996 Welfare Reform mm-hmm. Act, you know, this act imposed a 5-year lifetime limit on welfare. It excluded support for children who were born to moms who are already on welfare. So if you had a second kid or a third kid, you know, like that child supposedly was not, you know, allowed to get support from welfare. And then there was a lifetime ban on welfare benefits for people with drug felonies, mm-hmm. you know, and this originally excluded over 100,000 women from welfare programs from the get-go. And since then, different states have either opted out of it or modified it. But in the beginning, this just then meant that, like, if you had a drug conviction, boom, you weren't allowed. You know, the same thing with financial aid. So if you were like, okay, I'm out of prison, I want to go to college, I am now not qualified, you know, I now don't qualify for many types of financial aid. You know, I don't qualify for public housing. So, like, again, it kind of like, you know, like having that felony cuts out what little is left of the social safety net for so many people. Other issues? Yeah.
There's something called the Domestic Violence Survivor Justice Act that's being promoted, I know, in New York State
mm-hmm.
and probably outside of New York State too. Not a lot of people know about it, but in many instances, when a woman goes to court for having murdered her abuser,
mm-hmm.
who abused her for years and years and mm-hmm. years and years, and so one day she snapped and now he's gone, when she goes to court, none of what happened to her in the past is even considered
mm-hmm.
When they decide what kind of a sentence she's going to receive. They never consider what it was that drove her to that point.
Yes. Yes. And that happens, you know, like in New York State and in so many other places. And no, that act hasn't gotten a lot of publicity. It seems like the publicity around domestic violence is more about locking up more batterers and not like getting people, you know, people who are, you know, who have survived domestic violence and fall back out of the prison system. Other things that come to mind?
I mean, sort of coming off of this, I've heard anyway that most of the women convicted are coming from situations where they were involved, the crime that they were involved in at the moment was with a man. So it's more frequently for women that they're paired up with partners who are male. But I think one of the claims that have been made is that it's not always the case that they are willful participants. That is to say that women are less likely involved of their free will in the crimes that they're being charged with and ultimately convicted of.
Well, there's a couple of like things to
So
one of the things to keep in mind too is that women in prison, you know, like maybe more than people on the outside, you know, like have suffered a disproportionate amount of like abuse and battering even before they got arrested. You know, physical, sexual, you know, like emotional, mental abuse, mostly from loved ones. So reports have shown, and these are reports, so you figure that the numbers are higher because who wants to talk about their personal history with some person with a clipboard, you know, that comes around your prison cell? You know, that more than half of women in state prisons and jails reported having experienced physical or sexual abuse prior to their arrest and incarceration. And women are 3 times more likely than men to have been physically and or sexually abused before being incarcerated. So there's that aspect first, you know, like the fact that, like, you know, like a lot of people come from abusive situations or like were abused, you know, like, and some of that abuse could be, you know, like women have said, you know, like anecdotally, like, well, I did what I did because, you know, like, you know, my husband or my boyfriend told me that if I didn't do this, you know, he would beat me again. So that's why I carried this. That's why I cashed those false checks. That's why I, you know, like, so anecdotally, like they've talked about, you know, like these, you know, like I wouldn't be in here if it hadn't been for this, you know, And then in 1986, Congress passed the Anti-Drug Abuse Act. One of the provisions was that prosecutors and police were allowed to charge spouses and lovers as co-conspirators even if they did the things that spouses and lovers do when you live together, like take a phone message, you know, like in the days of landlines when somebody called and you picked up the phone and they said, is John there? And you said, no, John's not there. You take a phone message. And then like somebody comes in with a package and like, you know, like you sign for the package and say that message was about drugs and that package, you know, contained drugs. The police and prosecutors could then sweep up the spouse or the lover as part of, you know, like their conspiracy, and then they'd be like, okay, well, now you are being charged with conspiracy to X, Y, and Z, and because the spouse doesn't have any information to trade for a lesser charge, as her husband might, then she ends up being the one holding the bag for that charge. Whereas somebody, like her husband might be like, okay, I can give you the guy that sent me the package, all she can give them is John called at 3, the package came at 6. You know, like, and that's not enough information to plead down for a lesser charge. So, like, you know, like, and this has disproportionately brought the number of women up, you know, like, with the passing of that act. And then there are all sorts of other state laws, like drug laws, that have impacted, you know, like, how many people go to prison. You know, like, again, for things like, you know, like, I was in the car, or I was holding a small amount of drugs, or, you know, like, all these other things, like a direct result of like you do this or else, but you know, like things that happen when you like are in a relationship with a person. Put your hands up.
Political prisoners or enemies of the state become wards of the state.
Yes, yes. There are people in prison because of their political actions and their political beliefs, you know, like who then have been in prison, some for like over 40 years, you know, because of that. And there are women political prisoners as well. Am I leaving you out?
No, no.
Okay, I'm like, because if you need my attention, like, okay. Like, you're sitting here and, like, guarding this case. Other things that come to mind? All right, so a couple of things, you know, just to, like, you know, like, add on. So I talked about, you know, like, the number of, like, over 200,000 women in jails and prisons does not include people in immigrant detention. So according to ICE, women make up approximately 10% of its daily population on any given day. So that's roughly 3,000 women in immigrant detention any given day. There don't seem to be any numbers of how many trans women are in men's jails or prisons. Like, that doesn't seem to be something that like jails or prisons are interested in either keeping tabs on or making publicly accessible, and it's been really hard for outside groups to like be able to figure out what those numbers are. And when we talk about prisons, we need to be talking about and thinking about race, you know, because this is not like a colorblind system. So people of color are grossly overrepresented in the prison system. In 2011, the Bureau of Justice Statistics, which keeps tabs on certain statistics in prisons, reported that black women are 2.5 times more likely than white women to be sent to prison, and Latina women are nearly 1.5 times more likely than white women to be imprisoned. And they don't seem to have any publicly accessible statistics on other ethnicities, because, you know, obviously we don't all exist. you know, so, and this is not because women of color commit disproportionately more crimes, but we have to think about how racial profiling and policing plays into this. So an April 2005 study by the Department of Justice found that African Americans and Latinos are 3 times more likely than white people to be searched, arrested, threatened, or subdued with force when they're stopped by the police. And then, lest you think, well, now it is, you know, like 2013 and we have a law and all is well, you know, if you think that, you know, the New York Police Department was forced to release its statistics on stop and frisk, which is the New York policy where the police can stop someone on the street and, like, you know, like, and frisk them for, supposedly for guns, but most of the time they turn up, you know, small amounts of marijuana. And then they arrest the person for having small amounts of marijuana. And so when they released their statistics, they showed that of the 685,724 people who had been stopped on the street in 2011, nearly 90% were black or Latino. Hey there. keep in mind that black and Latino people make up about 53% of the city's population. You know, so of course when you stop and frisk, you know, like a disproportionate number of like, you know, like certain ethnicities, you're going to find more illegal substances on them than if you were like stopping and frisking the like 9% of, you know, white people. And then when you get to the court level, there's a discrepancy in how people are treated and sentenced. So A study in California showed that 2/3 of drug treatment slots were going to white people, despite the fact that 70% of people with drug sentences were African American. And there have been other studies that tracked how like people who are black and white, you know, like with similar backgrounds, et cetera, or like lack of criminal histories, you know, like have been treated as they go through like the legal system, you know. So again and again, white people are more likely to be offered, you know, like lesser charges, you know, like better deals, alternatives to incarceration than their African American counterparts. Okay, so now that we've like laid out all these amazingly horrifying realities, let's talk a little bit about resistance and organizing in women's prisons. So I'm sure most of you have heard about the hunger strike happening in Guantanamo, in which 103 of the 166 men still there have been on hunger strike for more than 100 days to protest their indefinite detention. So, and you brought up the fact that your sister is like 380 miles away from, you know, from home. So I'm going to open a story about hunger strike in a women's prison where somebody actually went on hunger strike to be moved closer to, you know, to her kids, which is not necessarily something we think of when we think of prison resistance and organizing. So in 1999, there was a woman named Irida Guanipa who was sent to a federal prison, or she was in a federal prison, and she'd been there for 3 years. And she was, you know, about 400 miles away from her children, you know, 380-something miles. And she, after 3 years of unsuccessfully requesting to be transferred to a prison closer to her children, of which there was a federal prison actually really close to her children, she was just like, enough is enough, and she staged a hunger strike. And she refused all food for 17 days. In response, prison officials placed her in a solitary confinement cell, and she continued her hunger strike. Her health started to fail, and the prison officials rushed her to the hospital and then returned her to solitary confinement for 32 more days. And then they transferred her to a prison, not in Miami, which had a federal prison and where her family was from, but to a prison that was about 300 miles away, instead of the 480 miles that she was in before. And then she repeatedly requested to like go to Miami, and they told her that there wasn't any room for her. And I bring up this because I wanted to like challenge you to think about how does her action of hunger striking and the issues of parenting and maintaining a connection to her children challenge what we think about when we think about prison resistance? You know, like, how does that kind of like, you know, like support this idea that prison resistance is all about certain issues and not others? And then, you know, like there are other ways that people inside women's prisons have organized and resisted in ways that maybe don't get seen as legitimate resistance and organizing. So continuing along with the story of Ida Guanipa, so she's now in a prison that's 300 miles away from Miami. And she's talking to the other women, and they're like, you know, we've never seen our kids either. You know, like we are 300 miles away, our families don't have the resources to like drive up here or take a bus up here or spend the night here with our kids. You know, this is expensive, it's far. And then she read about a bus program in West Virginia where a church sponsored a bus to take the kids, you know, like to visit their families in the federal prison. So she's just like, why can't we do this here? Now keep in mind that when you're in prison, you are not allowed to go around soliciting people to like help you do things. You know, like, this actually will get you another charge, and you can be like, you know, like, so basically you could be like, you know, like charged with an additional crime, and then like, you know, like, and then tried and sentenced and get more time of your sentence. So at great risk to herself, she decides that she's going to start this campaign for what she called the Free Bus Project. And so she spent 8 years writing to every organization whose address she could get her hands on. So if she got her hands on a church address, she wrote to this church. If she got her hands on like some other address, you know, like, and her letters were like, you know, basically, we moms here in this prison have not seen our children, some of us, for over a decade. Will you sponsor a bus to bring our kids? You know, and after 8 years, she finally found an organization, and she wouldn't say how because she didn't want to like necessarily, you know, like commit to like writing or anything else that she had done this highly illegal thing of, you know, getting transportation for kids to visit their moms. And they got a bus. And one weekend, 50 kids came to see their moms. And most of the moms were like, this is the first time I've seen my children since I've been locked up, you know? And again, this is like a way that she was able to do this, you know, like, and resist this, you know, destruction and this devastation of like, you know, like families by incarcerating people so far away. And it, but it's not something that like necessarily makes headlines or makes news, or it's like a really visible form of resistance. Women have also organized around like other issues involving their right to family and reproductive justice. So you mentioned shackling earlier. And you know, women have also organized against being shackled. So in 1993, women who were incarcerated in the District of Columbia actually filed a suit against the District of Columbia and actually stopped the practice of shackling pregnant women while they were in labor in jail. So like, you know, like they're organizing to stop this practice. You know, this is like a few years before the first actual legislation happened to, you know, legally protect women. I talked about the 2009 action, you know, like that women in New York State did. And more recently, women who were incarcerated in a Cook County jail, either like recently or way in the past, filed and finally won a several million dollar lawsuit, you know, because they've been shackled and they were like, we did not deserve, like we might have, you know, done something to end up in jail. We did not deserve to be shackled during labor, delivery, and postpartum recovery. And they filed a lawsuit and it went, did its way through the courts. And it finally, they finally reached a settlement agreement this past year in which they won like $4 million. So basically like that's a huge chunk of money for each of the women involved. But they also finally got the Cook County Jail to agree to stop shackling women while they're in labor and delivery. You know, because Cook County Jail had said, Cook County Jail is the major jail in Chicago. Jails oftentimes pretend that they are not part of like the Department of Correction system, like they're not part of the State Department of Correction system. So when legislation gets passed and says, no prison shall shackle pregnant women, they're like, well, we're not really a prison, so I guess we can keep doing what we're doing. So for years after Illinois had passed legislation saying that you couldn't shackle women in state prisons while they were in labor, delivery, and recovery, Cook County Jail continued to be like, well, we're not really a prison, so this legislation doesn't apply to us. And again, it wasn't until women like decided that they had enough and organized and filed a class action lawsuit that they were able to stop that. As I mentioned earlier, with the New York State Adoption and Safe Families Act and then Washington State, women who have been directly affected in New York State and Washington State have also been involved in organizing and speaking out, sharing their stories, and figuring out ways to get legislation passed that has adversely impacted them. And like, lest you be like, well, you know, like this is all like kind of reformist, you have to remember that people are in prison and there are like really immediate pressing issues that need to be dealt with. So while we should be looking at reducing the number of people inside prison and your prison pregnant, you only have this much time before your baby is born. You know, like, so being able to then be like, okay, you can be, you can give birth and not be shackled and chained, or you can give birth and know that you are not going to automatically lose your child, or like that timeline has not started ticking yet, is a win. You know, it would be an even better win if we weren't incarcerating pregnant women to begin with, but sort of like those baby steps mean a lot for the people who are currently inside. Yeah.
Prisons cause suicide, and they have the highest rates of suicide in any institution, and maybe in the country. That's actually captivity that is a cause of suicide, and the particular conditions like overcrowding and solitary confinement only exacerbate the rate.
Yeah. So, having kind of like laid out some of this, like what are some ways that you think that you can like either get involved or broaden whatever work that you're doing to like include, you know, organizing around issues of mass incarceration, you know, or women's incarceration and what you're doing? Just some ideas that you might have.
One thing I saw today actually was as you may not know, in Georgia as well as in California, there's been recent mass action within prisons. Around some of the conditions, particularly around special housing units and solitary confinement. In California, the hunger strikes are about to begin again on July 8th, and they're calling for support across the country, although that's not in women's prisons.
Actually, women's people in the secure housing units in California also were on hunger strike, and that seems to be a really little reported fact. So like Valley State Prison for Women, which recently closed down to become a men's prison, and they took all 1,000 women and shunted them into the already overcrowded other two women's prisons, you know, like also staged their own hunger strike during that time, both in solidarity with the men who had been in, you know, solitary confinement for years, if not decades, but also to be like, we don't want to be in solitary confinement indefinitely. These conditions are horrendous, vast amounts of abuse and mistreatment, you know, like, so they also launched their own hunger strike. And there's been very little reporting, very little information about that. I actually, you know, like, spoke with some loved one of one of the women that was on the Solidarity Hunger Strike, who was like, yeah, you know, like, and conditions might have improved, but then the prison system shut down. The prison system. Okay, I'm gonna back up a little bit, because I'm like, I don't know how many of you are familiar with California's prison system, which is massively overcrowded and bloated, and California is broke, and they keep incarcerating people. And so a state, the Supreme Court actually said that California's prison overcrowding was so awful, it was unconstitutional, and they needed to reduce the prison population so that they were only 137.5% of capacity, rather than whatever gargantuan number they were at before. Like, they weren't even like, get it 100%, get it 137%. And so to do this, the state started, instead of saying like, well, who doesn't need to be in prison, and should we start like making plans to let them out, they were like, let's start shuffling people. So like, let's shuffle some people to county jail, and then they're not in our prison system. Let's close this women's prison and put men in there, you know, and then they're technically out. Crowded in that, even though the women's prisons are overcrowded. And so now they're in the women's prisons, we're seeing women being put in these solitary confinement units, not because they've actually broken rules, but because there's no other place to put them. You know, so like, so again, like, I think when we like, so yeah, definitely supporting the like hunger strikes that are going to be happening, because nobody should be in a, you know, 6x10 box for months, decades, years, you know, like, that, like, that's just inhumane, but also remembering that it's not just one gender doing this, and also being like, who else is on this hunger strike, and why aren't we hearing about them, and also what's going on with them, like, if you are in the secure housing unit, the SHU, in California, you're not allowed to make phone calls. Almost all the women in the SHU are moms, and so they've spent years not being able to call their children and be like, hey, how are you? So again, when you think about, when we think about that, we should be like, okay, you know, like, who else is, you know, like, who else is being affected by this, and how then does this affect them as well? Other things
that? Even among prisoners who aren't in solitary confinement, some prisons, I don't know, but like maximum security prohibit socialization just among the prisoners, or they don't even, even if it's not considered solitary confinement, they have like prohibitions about conversation and talking. So that's like a cruel and unusual thing to deprive people of a social life, even within, you know, the isolation in a rural area.
So tease that out. So how then can people in this room kind of like work around that or incorporate work against that and what they're doing?
Well, I mean, it's probably not particular just to women, but I'm...
This wouldn't necessarily be organizing around people who are currently incarcerated, but making sure that in hiring practices or housing decisions that we're not necessarily automatically excluding people who have been incarcerated, so allowing people to, you know, tell the story of what their situation is. And so, you know, not having on like job applications boxes that say, have you been incarcerated?
Yes. Yes. I don't remember if New York State has that box. In several states, there have been like this movement called Ban the Box, in which formerly incarcerated people have actually been, won the right to like get that box taken off the initial application so that potential employers don't originally be like, you know, formerly incarcerated, out, you know, like, discard immediately, but like, you know, like, to give them that chance to like apply like everybody else who like hasn't been incarcerated, and then when it comes up later to be able to explain that. But yes, so like, you know, like doing things like not discriminating based on, you know, like based on that initial knee jerk, like, hey, you were in prison, what?
Well, one thing we have in Western New York is that we are very close, or much closer than New York City, to a lot of the places like Albion Women's Prison and other prisons up here. And so there are a lot of ways that our position in the state is a disadvantage to participating in these sort of statewide things, but then we have advantages our proximity gives us, and that can be everything from visiting people, who don't otherwise have visitors, to facilitating other people visiting them, their family, loved ones. And then I think also more generally it's important to do the work of keeping people out of prisons and,
yes.
And trying to mm-hmm. prevent youth incarceration and women's incarceration through a variety of things. And you know, for a lot of women, it's the abusive relationships and domestic abuse that are big sort of funnel into the prison system. So thinking about how to support women in those situations is really important.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Other folks? I think quite a bunch in comparison to like earlier, where everybody had suggestions on how to support families, and now it's here.
I mean, even given what you just said, it seems to me like often, you know, there's this particular age group demographic that's showing up to organizing meetings. So you often like highlight things that are that matter to you or that you sympathize with. I think like Occupy people got all like heavy about student debt, and I'm not saying that's not an important issue, but the issues we prioritize in our meetings and in our activism generally. I think should take account of, you know, where people are who are coming out of prison, who are coming into prison.
We would say probably the intersectionality of that as well. I mean, I know women have been arrested at their jobs because of student debt. Women earn less money,
mm-hmm.
so, you know, resorting to X, Y, Z, to, so that's a brilliant idea. It's maybe kind of tough sometimes because people can get a pet issue and don't like dilute the focus or whatever, but they're all connected anyway, so you might as well bring up the ways that they are.
I think there's a lot of ways that that can relate to Occupy too, because there was a recent statistic that came out that was like, and this is just what's reported again, it's way more than this in actuality, but 8,000 people in this country were arrested with Occupy-related things. I know way a lot more were arrested in LA than were reported because I was there. So, and also the people that were arrested were abused. Like one of my friends had his shoulder torn, like the cuff, the rotator cuff torn. And of course, there was nothing that he could do. But so there, it is so intimately related, and the police state was triggered by Occupy. So it seems like it could be such an easy connection with that group specifically. That could be a way to talk about it or to bring it, maybe bring it up with the GA or something. Anyway. Yeah. Or write about it.
Other things that you want?
Maybe some, one way is to connect sort of the two things that you've been talking about and to provide the sort of community support for women and children.
Yes.
Who are incarcerated, to make sure that they have the sort of support systems where their children don't have to go into foster care.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, I think even just sort of establishing lines of communication. I was recently at a conference where the speaker is coming out with a book about the experience of being in prison, sort of a philosophical account of this. And she teaches a philosophy course at a to inmates on death row, and it was really interesting hearing her talk. And at the end of her presentation, she handed out just postcards of designs that inmates had made. They had their addresses on them, and she encouraged all of us to fill out those postcards and just sort of connect with the inmates there. And so, I mean, just sort of a very simple thing of, like, you know, I think a lot of us. Maybe many of us don't have the experience of, say, well, what do you say to someone in prison?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that sort of exercise of sitting down and trying to open up, say, a line of communication with people who don't have an outlet or that particular connection to the outside world, I think is actually really important as well.
Definitely. Other suggestions? I just want to make sure that nobody else who hasn't spoken, like, you know, like gets a chance to speak. Anyone else?
Well, it's just when you think of families being divided, it's something you think of in war-torn countries, not with the prison system, you know, dividing families and separating them indefinitely. And it's just, I mean, it's part of the country where there's more prisoners here than any other, I mean, higher prison rate than anywhere else in the world. So it's just hard to believe that happens.
Mm-hmm. I have a question, actually. Are there like Skypings like available or anything like that so that people can video, like nothing like that?
So apparently in the New Jersey women's prison, and this doesn't seem to be like a universal thing and it's really limited, you can like get like a teleconference, but it's super expensive. It's like $30. Mm-hmm. So if you make like, you know, like 30 cents an hour, you know, like you are saving up a long time.
Is it $30 an hour or what?
It's $30 for like your like 10 to 15 minute call. And you have to get the approval of, you know, of the warden, and it has to be deemed beneficial to like both parties and blah, 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 blah. So like, but that's the only time I've ever heard of anybody being able to like video see. But for the most part, it is collect phone calls, which are hugely expensive. Like they're more than like if you were, say, to call collect from the outside. Like there's it's something like $15 for 15 minutes. Which again, if you think about the fact that most people come from low income communities and their families are low income, and the people taking care of their children or loved ones are low income, like they're not going to be able to afford a lot, if any, of those calls, or it's snail mail. And that those are like the ways of communicating, unless the person can actually go out there and see me.
Is there any type of program in place where like organizers on the outside can say like raise funds for calling cards and then distribute those to people on the inside so that they don't have to put the burden of the collect call on their families, but those will be some.
I actually don't know if there's any campaigns or groups that do that. I do know that there is a campaign for phone justice that's actually been trying to like, you know, like get the FCC to like stop awarding contracts to different phone companies, where basically like you get one phone company in that prison and they get to set the rates. They get to set, you know, these enormous, you know, gigantic rates for this collect call. So they've been working to decrease that so that that way, you know, people can maybe call home more often or at all. But I don't know, so that's the campaign for phone justice that we'll talk about later, but I don't know of any groups that are actively working to like try to get, you know, money into people's accounts so that that way they can, you know, afford to call home without burdening their loved ones.
This raised to my mind in your discussion here the idea of targeting prison profiteers and making sure that people know who they are. It seems to me AT&T shouldn't be allowed to mention, I mean, they shouldn't even be allowed to put a commercial on where people don't know that they are stealing in such crazy ways from
yeah.
people who are involved. Mm-hmm. And potentially there's lots of products that you can pretty easily associate with that.
Yes.
Vicki, you're saying it was getting a little close to 9. So
okay. All right. All right.
You've done us more than justice.
Right. I'm like just like judging from the light, but yeah. I guess you guys are closer to
yeah.
the more. You guys
yes.
have more light than we do down south. So I want to like close out with a couple of like concrete things. There's some ways that women themselves have suggested. They have said more communication from the outside. You know, like mail is a really strong motivator. Also, guards pay attention to who doesn't ever get mail, right? So if they notice at mail call that you never get mail, guess who is getting picked on a lot more than the person who is constantly getting letters and cards from loved ones? You know, so like even like a short postcard, that like works. You know, like if you're like, I don't know what to say, just be like, hey, you know, hope you're doing okay. Hey, you know, there was a march today. Hey, you know, something, daffodils, you know, something. You know, like, but something that kind of like, A, breaks through that isolation and also sends out, you know, sort of like a warning, like somebody actually cares about this person. Speaking out about these issues and connecting them to other struggles, I really like the idea of like, you know, like using the like whole like, you know, like momentum of Occupy to like be like, and when we're talking about debt and privilege and poverty, like let's talk about, you know, this. When we're talking about police brutality, let's talk about that, you know, to like basically bring more people in and see that it's not just prisons are here and my issue is here, but no, they actually do intersect. Writing articles, or if you have access to like newspapers or internet, publishing theirs. YouTube.
Is there mail read? So like if they were to write and say, hey, I was raped today by a guard, is that the read?
Mail is read or it's spot read. So like people who are considered problematic, like say if you're a political prisoner or if you've been involved in lawsuits and grievances, they will definitely read that person's mail. If you are Jane Schmo and you haven't given them reason to think that you're causing problems, a lot of times they don't bother reading it or they'll flip through it, you know? So it depends on the person and it depends on like, you know, like the institution.
So would the mail be censored bit by bit according to the information, or would it be just denied?
It might be denied. Like, I've never gotten a letter where it's like, you know.
They're just honest.
Yeah, like the thing that you see in the movies, I haven't seen.
Yeah.
Did you have a follow-up question or another question?
It was just, I wanted to make sure that, people, everybody here is aware of a group called Prisoners of People Too, which is a local group that is right now. I mean, they give support, of course, to prisoners, but one of the initiatives is the reentry. Just not really any, solid program as such, but just kind of brainstorming and whatnot. What we can do as a community to provide and make sure people have the support they need. But the next meeting for that is June 24th, because I'm kind of a stickler for concrete things that we can do.
Yes.
And that's one thing. Prisoners of People Too again, and then also Buffalo Save the Kids is a new group specifically interested in working within the detention facilities with the youth. And so we're just trying to set up help increase the peace programs like conflict resolution, mm-hmm. and also helping to create a communication between adults in prison, mm-hmm. and the kids, so that there's something they can share their experiences.
And then two more things that are Buffalo specific, like piggybacking on the concrete things. So I don't know if you all heard or if you have kids in the school system or not, but apparently a new code of conduct for the Buffalo school system got passed this past April. You know, that basically stops a lot of the push out of students from schools for being suspended for things like truancy or cheating or cutting class or running in the hallways and all the things that really nobody should be suspended for, and I guess apparently, and I didn't know this, not being from your city, Buffalo has consistently had the highest rate of out-of-school suspensions in the state, with a one in five, and some statistics even put it at 1 in 4 students being suspended, and the New York State average is 1 in 20. So mobilizing to kind of stop some of that school pipeline.
Action.
Yes.
I don't know if they do it everywhere, but I went to certain court cases. And the judge was sent to jail for being in class.
Yeah, we're seeing an increasing criminalization of youth, particularly youth of color and low-income youth of color, for things that used to just merit go write lines on the board or go whatever, whatever the thing was that kids, used to do, which was a dumb, boring thing, is now now we're going to be suspending you, now we're going to be arresting you, we're going to be charging you. And so I guess with this new code of conduct, schools will be used, relying more on intervention strategies, seating changes and apologies and notifying parents and conflict resolution rather than more punitive measures from the get-go. So again, that's just something that I read that was, interesting. And for you all in Buffalo, that's also something maybe to keep in mind to be hey, is this actually being implemented? Because it's one thing to have a code of conduct that's nice on paper and you're still, and it's another thing to actually make sure it's being implemented. And then one last Buffalo thing is that there is something on the table right now called the Safe Parole Act, which is a bill that formerly incarcerated people and prison families spent years pulling together. That basically takes away the parole board's, evaluation of whether the person is ready to be released based on, quote unquote, the seriousness of their crime. Because a lot of times the parole board, or most of the time the parole board will be like, well, there's the seriousness of your crime that happened 35 years ago, so basically you're not eligible. And apparently, you all have a senator named Tim Kennedy, who is from the Buffalo area, and would probably be really moved at hearing from people who could potentially vote him in or out of office. So I have information about this Safe Parole Act, which groups in New York have been working on trying to get people to write letters for. And then they were like, hey, you're going to Buffalo. We have something for you. So whether or not you vote for this guy afterwards, I don't care. But he probably would be very likely to pay more attention to say you all in the Buffalo area saying hello, I live in Buffalo, I may potentially vote for you or not, you should pass this bill. And again, it's one of those things that hopefully will get more people out of prison. So people who are being denied parole again and again and again because quote unquote the seriousness of the crime that might have happened a decade or more ago, or in the cases of some of the prisoners, so 40, 40, 40 years ago, so what's it, 40 decades ago, four, you know, four decades ago, like, then can't be held against them. You know, and there are a lot of other things, too, that, like, I don't want to say it would, like, level the playing field for parole, but would remove some of the, like, you know, like, larger
things. Yeah. I just wanted to say that this is a serious danger of our time. We do a lot of work with political prisoners, a number of them being from former Black Panthers, Black Liberation Army members, and they're also essentially coming down. They're always hit with serious injuries and kind of become a little bit more. So this is like really a huge deal. These guys are getting really old, and this is not getting them out of the program.
Yes.
So this is, I mean, I'm really glad that you brought me. And as if everybody would like take this to heart and learn about it. It's a really, really, really big deal. And can you say what it can be, like, is he part of the committee or anything?
So apparently he is a Republican sponsor of this bill. You know, like, so like, again, that, like, added, of course, you know, like, is he a Democrat?
But he almost lost his election last year to Betty Jean Grant, and I think in response he's had to move a little bit more to the left. He was out today in Massachusetts supporting a bill around farm worker labor. So I think this is actually a really good time to be writing to him, that he knows that the more liberal constituency, the amount of money he spent and the amount of money Betty Jean Grant spent was insanely disproportional, and he came very close to losing his seat.
Except there was some tinkering with the election process there that skewed the results in his favor.
Right, but just still the point being that he almost lost, and he spent way more money than she did. So this might be a moment that's exactly paying attention.
Yeah. And as Teresa pointed out, like, for some people, especially the political prisoners, I mean, say this would be a huge deal, you know, like, and hopefully, okay, I don't want to jinx it, like, you know, but hopefully, like, a way to, like, you know, like, get them out, you know, like, because that removes one of the hurdles, you know, of the many hurdles that they've been facing in, like, securing their freedom. Okay, so on that note, I will, like, officially close, so people who have, like, you know, like, other things to do or are tired or whatever can get up and stretch and move out. But thank you so much. I'm around if you have any other questions. There are books on the table. There are copies of Tenacious, which is a zine of art and writing from women in prison, both cisgender women in women's prisons and some trans women in men's facilities. Those are $3. If you pick up a copy, feel free to write postcards to any of the people whose addresses are in there, because I'm sure they would love to hear from folks on the outside. And thank you.
Thank you.